better if I present myself through the we have the remote system of changing slides. Through my original research, that's my PhD project, which was dedicated to the ideas on higher education in Europe. So basically my question was what higher education means in modern Europe. So if in previous century it was an essential constitutive element of a nation state, what is it today? I was looking into only into discourses and documents, texts and contexts on the European level. So I didn't go into national systems, into several national environments for higher education. Maria, you can go ahead with the I focused the documents, the conferences, the policy process on the European level, being European Union, being Bologna process, being other processes, other organizations like Council of Europe, for example. So civil society and political organizations that deal with higher education on European level. For this purpose, I used the discursive institutionalism, and now I'm going into the analytical framework, which I also used for the research I'm presenting today. So what is important, I will not go into details about discursive institutionalism. What is important is that discursive institutionalism I found useful for my research because it goes into situations where there is communicative action, where there is some political happening, some discussion, some negotiation going on, so where there is a production of papers, of discourses, communication, negotiation, and so on. There, the discursive institutionalism goes and scratches under the surface to find what are the ideas beneath. So it's a combination between the institutionalist tradition and constructivist approach to social science. So the institutions are not only structures that determine human behavior. The institutions are also constructs of humans and actors and agents themselves. So it's a mix between agency and structure approach too. but it was not enough. I'm a bit sometimes curious what's the big picture, and to get the big picture, sometimes one has to be more critical, see things from distance, see what are the structures behind what is the time telling us, the time where we are living, and so on. Can you go to the next slide? That's why I also combined discursive institutionalism with historical materialism, with a neo-Gramscian version of it. So besides material conditions that determine the way the things happening, our world and the dynamics within it, also institutions and ideas form together historical structures. So the processes I'm looking at happen in a certain historical structures, which are constituted by social forces, grouped in material conditions. So what are the economic relations, social relations, and so on. Institutions that determine us. Education is one of the institutions, but the institutions can be a very broad concept. And ideas. Ideas are not just product of the institutions. Ideas are part of the constant interaction between actors and agents and so on. This is what I did in exploring my field work more or less. So I was spent a lot of time in Brussels, in Strasbourg, in Bonn, in archives at various universities, at archives, the ministries, and so on. talked with a lot of people to get to the real overview of the situation and to the discourses and so on. For those who came late, I'm looking into ideas and discourses on higher education on European level. Maria, towards conclusions, one of the main conclusions which I put on the slides, or conclusions of, or the main achievement was the deconstruction or the demystification of Bologna process. No, Bologna process is the most probably one of the most discussed things in, or has been in the last decade and a half in our universities. And I came to the conclusion that Bologna cannot be treated as one monolith. It's just a forum where the policies were created, discussed, negotiated, and where there has been an intensive discussion about higher education in Europe. But then, what is important to compare for the later stage of presentation is on the next slide. I came to the conclusion that in Europe there are three streams of ideas, intermingled, of course, about higher education. The blue cloud talks about the old values and norms, the very normative ideas of higher education that stem from the 19th century idealist humanist views on organizing society, politics, and so on, which see higher education as the constitutive part of the nation state, as a universities as the engines of progress, of human advance, of advance of knowledge, which will make our life better and so on. But in the blue and the normative cloud of ideas, there is also the emerging ideas. Now I'm going a bit through the history of European universities of the last 22 centuries. In the 20th century, after two big world conflicts, there was a new wave of ideas, a new zeitgeist that brought the egalitarian ideas back to the surface in the form of social rights and social democratic ideational hegemony, where higher education was viewed as a means for emancipation of various social classes. So this was a period after World War II, where you saw a big increase in enrollment in higher education, especially in the Western Europe, a bit later also in the Eastern part with the different political system. The second stream of ideas, you will recognize it under the concept of knowledge economy, knowledge society. It's basically about higher education, and it's very modern. This is very nowadays conceptualization of higher education. Higher education as an instrument for economic competitiveness. See, higher education can be engaged into making our economies more competitive in the world. So Europe is competing with the world, and higher education is the crucial element in it. It changes. It has always been important for economy, but now it's becoming central to the idea. And this idea is not normative as it is the one in the blue cloud. It's not the appropriateness that is the guiding argument. The guiding argument is the necessity. We need to make our universities contributing to our economy by producing skilled labor and by generating innovation, research for our companies to have the production of high-tech services and goods. And the third one, which runs much more in the back, so you cannot see it in directly in the texts and discourses, but it's present because of the change of social relations, is the commodification of higher education. Commodification is a bit difficult word, but it's about treating higher education as a tradable good. So higher education is not only an institution in society, it's also business nowadays. There is several tens of billions of dollars of business in transnational higher education. For example, in Britain, it was decided already in the 90s on the policy level that higher education will be encouraged to as an export industry of services. And all the policy of British government in the international organizations was directed into this direction. Today, Britain is having a big inflow of foreign students that bring money with the tuition fees, and has British universities have a lot of campuses, branch campuses in other countries out of European Union, which is also a lucrative activity. It's not the first one. Ahead of Britain is, for example, Australia and New Zealand. So these three streams of ideas were identified in Europe with the second one, with the instrumentalization as the main political rationale, as the main political topos of our times. I just fell asleep. I have to, some from time to time, I have to. Also, if I take the EU discourses, which will come back later, in EU discourse, the instrumentalization of higher education is quite strongly present, and the knowledge-based economy and society is not from EU, but it's a lot used by EU discourse texts and policy papers and so on. Can go on. Now Latin America. So this was my research, my personal project, and then I applied to Tuning Academy because I wanted to see what's going on in the other continent. In Europe we have a problem. We think that that we are in the center. At least when it comes to universities and higher education, we think this university is a concept which was born in Europe, and the university is famous from Europe, now also from US, that we forget to look in what is the difference in the educational traditions in other continents, and I wanted to get over this, so not be obsessed only with Europe and see what is going on in Latin America, especially because also Europe has very intensive political cooperation with Latin America also in the field of education. So I asked myself more or less questions in three fields, comparing the two systems, also in the historical terms, as I said before, the historical materialism element in my research. How European ideas sound in America, Latin American context, and what are the specifics of Latin America which Europe doesn't know or has not experienced. And we are, of course, talking all the time about mass higher education. This is very important. Higher education is not a romantic story. It has to be taken as it is. And higher education of today is a mass higher education. So the third big change, which I mentioned before in the history of higher education in Europe, was massification. If before only 3, 4, 5% of each generation cohort enrolled in higher education, now we are passing 50% in most European states. So 50% of your classmates from primary school are ending up in some sort of higher education nowadays. In Germany, a bit less, in Britain, a bit more, but there we are. So nothing is like it was before. We cannot talk anymore about the romantic university. We have mass higher education with massification. There is more types of higher education institutions than just the typical old university. There is more teaching staff. There is more administrative staff. There is everything is different. But this was a bit of a detour. We can go on. So I went hands-on, but the most important insight into Latin America for me was the one in red here. I participated in the second phase of Tuning project. Now I tell a bit, because there's a lot of external people, I have to tell a bit about Tuning. Tuning is a project which aims at bringing across methods and curricular elements which help to reform the way of teaching, assessing, in higher education, teaching, learning, assessment in higher education and quality care on the very low, on the very basic level. So in the classroom, on the curricular level, on the syllabi level, and involves academic teaching staff, and to a minor extent also students. So this is the project which is run by University of Deusto, financed by European Commission. Tell me if I'm wrong. Financed by European Commission, and it's been going on already from the early 2000s, late 90s was the idea, immediately when Bologna process started. It's a bit of implementation of Bologna on a very micro level. And for example, the key element is the outcome-based methods of teaching and learning. So instead of input-based, so what we will teach, we look at what comes out, so what the student can do when they finish their school. What are their competences, what are their skills, and so on. And now the whole curricular reform has to be implemented through this idea, to look at the outcomes. ECTS, for example, European Credit Transfer System, is also part of this idea. Because ECTS tells you how much workload was needed to achieve certain learning outcomes. It changes completely the concept of education. Until now, it was input-based. The teacher said, listed what he will teach. So that's much about tuning. I was the tuning started in Europe with European universities, and now and then later started the project also in other continents. The first one out of Europe was Latin America. It involves now around 200 universities, if I'm not wrong. So the participants of the project are teachers of the universities of Latin America, and also representatives of ministries, but they don't have a central role. The central role goes to teachers from different disciplines. It's divided into disciplines. So there I was together with one of the working groups, in all the meetings, in the mailing and so on. I could follow their discussions, I could follow the progress of their work and their approaches, their ideas, and so on. I also talked a lot with them in the free time, lunch breaks, dinners, sometimes parties as well. In Latin America there's a lot of party. And then I went through political documents, side documents, of course interviews, and I have also three collaborators. Two of them are helping me to collect interviews in Latin America, one in Mendoza, the other in Quito, Mendoza, Argentina. And I have a collaborator who helps me with the political documents, with the documents which I will present in seguida. Next one. But before, I talked about how the higher education changed in Europe. Now a bit about how it changed in Latin America, very quickly. Colonial times, elite model transfer from Spain to Latin America, from Portugal to Latin America. The old universities, loyal to crown and church, transferring models of organizing society and culture. Then 19th century comes, decolonization, independence, and also the ideas from Europe came of nation state and higher education as one of the main building brick of the nation state. The Napoleonic model was the dominant new model of university. Napoleonic model of university is the model where university prepares the professionals for the state. For the state jobs, like civil service, engineering. So what the state needs, university teaches for. But then early 20th century brought an interesting shift. Here the university is still very elite. It's still reproducing the elites of society. And all of a sudden there was a very instantaneous event at the University of Cordoba in Argentina, where the students demanded new type of university. They wanted to democratize university because they wanted to fight the oligarchy in society, which was very oligarchic in Latin America back in times, still heritage from colonial times, very narrow upper class and working and farmers, working class and farmers beneath. But students saw the necessity for democratization, and they demanded the reforms, and they changed completely the structure of university. I will come back to this. Next. Then the second half of 20th century, the massification in Latin America started in 1918. Yeah? So the Cordoban reform is also about opening the university. So that's decades before Europe opened up their doors to other social classes than just elite. But in the second half of 20th century, the massification of big proportion in other countries than just Argentina and Chile started to occur. The university was still very detached from the political life and from economic life, and therefore resisted also the notorious military junta, military coups, and the regimes following them especially in the 70s. From the 80s to recently, Latin America was under the patronage, very heavy patronage of international organizations such as World Bank, and the liberalization, deregulation took place, and we had a surge of private universities. It's here. So the surge of private universities, which led to a more diverse system. So besides state central universities, we have now also a lot of private universities, which makes a rather diverse system. Considerably more private universities than we can see in European countries, especially, for example, Chile, Colombia, the countries which were more heavily influenced by the US and the international organizations such as WTO. So this is the situation of today, but as I promised, let's go back and see what happened in Cordoba, because Cordoba is the Cordoba Revolution, is what makes the system of universities, higher education in Latin America different from what we have in Europe. So in 1918, there was this detour from the development, which we could see in Europe. Not detour, but a split, I would say. It put up only five principles, which you will find probably interesting, I thought, and I found them the most distinctive ones of this reform. So cogobierno, the university is by rule governed by the combination of students, teachers, graduates, and administrative staff in some cases. But these three groups govern the universities. No top-down governing of the university is bottom-up governing of the university through elections. And this is rule. That doesn't go over. It's not possible to have any other type of system. So a very democratic structure of the institution. Extension. University is not locked in itself. It's not an ivory tower. It works with society, especially with the worker unions, with different courses, evening courses, and so on, with the deprivileged, underprivileged social groups and other groups of society. So it's actively involved with society as part of its mission and as part of its daily activity. And then autonomy of teaching, research, and administration. This goes very well along with the Humboldtian principle of university from the 19th century in Europe. So researchers are protected from the economy and from politics when they are doing their research. There's no influence from outside. The researcher has to do its work, and the science has to go its way. No corruption in this sense. And then what is interesting nowadays, if somebody deals with reorganizing university, is the fluency of positions. The teachers are hired always through public calls. One, and second, they have only 5 years mandate. This prevents, you know, in trade unions would say here, it's a precarization of employment and so on. No, in Argentina, it was preventing the oligarchy in the university. So the old professors crushed to reform again, to recompose itself. Now they had only 5 years mandate, and each time they had to prove their academic results and their merits and so on, and be accepted by this committees who were formed by students, graduates, and teachers. And then the last one, free education, no tuition fees. Education is open for all and has to be accessible, and that therefore is not something that one pays for. This idea was pretty much early in comparison to Europe, the last one. That's why I said before, 1918. In Europe in 1918 was destroyed by the First World War, that there was not much of thinking about these social democratic ideas at the time. But we will go on now. The views of Europe in Latin America. Now, I'm asking, what do Latin American context say? What does Latin American context say about European ideas coming in through all these initiatives like tuning? Some of them say that it's an opportunity for reforming, for thinking about reforming Latin American education, who is in need of reform because of massification. I highlighted Cordoba, but after Cordoba you saw there was a lot of things going on. So now higher education in Latin America looks much different than it looked at the beginning of the 19th century. Then some of them see an opportunity for the very low level of integration of the continent to proceed through higher education. So higher education as an element of integration of the Latin American continent. The Che Guevara dream from decades ago. But there is also skeptics who say European Union only has the interest to open more markets for the universities in Europe to sell education in Latin America. That's the critics. And the other critics on a more philosophical level say, Europe is recolonizing Latin America through education, spreading again the values, cultures, and ideas through higher education to dominate, to impose hegemony over, or to establish hegemony over this part of the world. Now let's see what do the papers say, does the field material say. I analyzed some regional political activities. There is a series of meetings. The ministers of Latin America have met a lot. But there was a lot of political paper which didn't have any effect in practice. There was no follow-up, there was no implementation. But recently there is this conference of regional conference of higher education in Latin America. It's called CEPS, and I took the 2008 meeting, analyzed the papers, because this process is very much structured like it was the Bologna process. So it's comparable first, and it has some practical practical follow-ups, which we will see later. So I analyzed the papers of this conference. Don't get afraid of the amount of words. It's just quotings from the papers. So on one hand, we have a very strong and prevailing discourse that addresses inequality. It refers to Cordoban University Revolution. So that revolution became a norm, a value. The achievements of that revolution, of that reform, some people call it revolution, some reforms, became part of the identity of public Latin American universities, the big ones, the traditional ones. Sustainable development, social inclusion, regional solidarity, equal opportunities, human, economic, social, and cultural rights, equality, distribution of wealth, multicultural integration, cultural heritage. So these are the prevailing the concepts which I brought up to you to make a bit of impression how they talk about higher education. There is some traces of economic discourse, but very little in this document. So there is segments of the document, minor segments, that talk about the changing global context, about the need to adjust, about the need to change. and also about the cooperation between the government, universities, research centers, and the sector productivo. That would be a sort of equivalent of the knowledge economy discourse in Europe, but not exactly the same. So it's very, very carefully bringing up also the necessity to adjust universities to the needs of economy, which is very blasphemic in Latin America. The discourses, of especially in public universities between students and also some academia, it's always oriented towards being protected from the external influence. That also means from economy, from the interests of capital, from the interests of business and so on. But on political level, this is visible. And then, unlike Bologna and EU documents, the political document from CRES condemns and rejects very explicitly the commodification of higher education. Plus, it says that there is a need to regulate the flow of foreign capital. So the political arena identified the presence of transnational education and of this lucrative business of higher education spreading also throughout Latin America, and express a very clear stance against it. For example, Bologna process, and this is a particular in Bologna process which is very interesting, there was no consensus about condemning commercialization of higher education. On one side it was France who wanted to condemn it, on the other side it was Britain who wanted to avoid this topic. My bad luck that I'm the first, so the equipment is not yet under control. Next one. Now, the second event and second initiative that I analyzed is the initiative between EU and Caribbean. I announced before that I will come back to this, and here it is. European Union has an intense cooperation program with the Latin American countries, and one of the fields of cooperation is higher education. It came to the point that it got from political to already academic level, and there is this initiative, the name is EULAC in English. It's been constructed from the late 90s, and it's establishing a common higher education area between Europe and Latin America. Tuning was a product, so why tuning came to Latin America was also because the ministers and the academics from within this initiative requested tuning to be performed, devised also for Latin American context. And now we will go a bit into the discourse. Here the things change. As soon as European Union was involved, you see how the balance of discourse shifts towards a more economic instrumental ideas. So the idea of higher education as a means for economic development or the economic performance, it's much more present here than it was in the other document. It's true that there is also a time difference. This is very recent. The other one was 2008. But on the other hand, it's visible, because certain elements inside, like the mentioning of labor market, that's very typical for a European Union discourse, but was not present before in the documents of Latin America. So we stay with these declarative values, but we have more of instrumental view of higher education. In this productive sector, I like to emphasize it because it's completely different way of a term to address the economy, the business in Latin America, in Castellano, than in English. So it's productive sector. Can go on. So the commonalities between the two continents, it's the identification of global changes. There is some context out there which makes us change. This is the same in both continents. The massification of higher education and the necessity to reform higher education because of massification. We have still the universities from before, but there is so many more students, there is so many more teachers, it requires a different organization to make it work. The internationalization of higher education, the idea that higher education has to go international is very much present for different reasons though, in Europe and in Latin America. The emancipatory purpose. Europe retains the idea that social dimension, the access, the quality is part of the mission of higher education, of the purpose of higher education. And the detection and opposition to commodification of higher education. In Latin America, explicit, in Europe, implicit with some voices of dissent, like Great Britain. Now, the differences. I will not go one by one, but the main ones, because a lot of them I mentioned before. Democratic values in the universities, public universities, private, it's a totally different story in Latin America. It's very strong, still very strong, the Cordoban values. Whereas in Europe, we are talking about managerial reforms of university, which means a more top-down approach, more management, more outcome-oriented governance of university and so on. The autonomy, the concept of autonomy goes along with this. While autonomy in Latin America means protection of university community and the organization of university community, democratic organization and freedom of teaching, freedom of research and so on, academic freedom. In Europe, autonomy is contextualized as autonomy of university management. So the senior management has to be autonomous to run the funds in a way that is most efficient possible. Yeah. And then what else can I mention? I'm running out of time. For example, the responding to the society. This is in both contexts is very present. So the university has to respond to society. Whereas in Latin America, it's about social inclusion, about solidarity, equality, and so on. In Europe, it's responding to the needs of economy. So producing adequate skills for the labor market, producing innovation, research, and so on. Go on. Crucial difference, which makes tuning work very well in Latin America, is that the Latin American system is bottom heavy. So when I interviewed the people who were involved, the deans, the professors who were involved in tuning Latin America, they were not against. There was skepticism, but very little. They were very much in favor of changing their way of teaching, the way of learning, but in several cases without changing the main ideas of university. For example, University of Mendoza in Western Argentina, they want to retain the values of Cordoban University, even though changing the way of teaching and learning as to the outcomes oriented one. Weak regional integration, it's crucial. For Latin America, there will not be all the authors agree that there will not be something like Bologna process working in Latin America because the system is not top-down, it's very bottom-up. If something will be done in higher education, it will be done from the bottom. And here tuning again comes to fertile soil because it addresses the bottom. Democratic structure and co-governing as an obstacle to reform. So we have this voting system, especially in the main universities, University of Chile, for example, or University in Buenos Aires, the public ones. They are very critical to what comes from United States, a bit less to what it comes from Europe, but still critical. This might be an obstacle for bigger changes in these universities. But in the private universities, they say that they are pragmatic. They call the public universities as political. I put their critical reflection. That's my way of saying. Whereas the privates call themselves that we are pragmatic. We are pragmatic. We implement the changes which will make our universities more competitive, more agile, more useful for the labor market and so on. So they go into this instrumental type of ideas much easier than the public universities. Why focusing tuning? The research hasn't finished yet. I did a part, and I still have to do a lot, especially with my two colleagues in Ecuador and Argentina. Tuning, it turned out the tuning carries a quite heavy political weight. So it is something that it means a lot in the political circumstances of Latin America, especially in the field of higher education. It's important to see the broader picture of tuning. So what does tuning encounter in terms of ideas and changes in higher education in Latin America? And this is now the reverse view. What can bring knowing more about tuning Latin America is what can Europe learn from Latin America and not only the way around. So there is specifics in Latin American higher education that work well there and that might be somehow an inspiration for European reforms. One of such things which I view as interesting is how it's organized the recruitment procedure for teachers. In Europe we have a problem all over in all countries that we have this crust of old established professors and we have this young emerging academics that cannot go beyond certain point until the old professors are retired. So this is one of the ideas that can be taken from. The interview is, but this is a bit of a taste because I only had 5 interviews and some more conversation. They are positive towards tuning. They see necessity for change, all of them. I mixed the interviewees, that bit of them from public, from private universities, small provincial, big capital city universities. They see the necessity to involve labor market into the discussion on higher education. They see the difference between private and public. The identity is very strong. If you interview a person from or talk to a person from private university, he will underline that he's from private and that this is different from public and vice versa. And reference to the values, especially academics from public universities, I mentioned before the Mendoza case, but throughout Latin America when I talk to them, especially Argentina, they refer to the values that the university carries along. And this is, I think, all to this point. Thank you.